Hello, you malty MV Augustas. Ralphie here with Whisky Review 330, the first review from Ralphie.com in the year 2013. Oh, so many years. So many years. Now, thank you to Frontside Bus for that malt mention. I suspect that Frontside Bus is a bit of a biker, because an MV Augusta is a motorbike. A rather expensive one, actually. Very classy road racing bike. I particularly like the old vintage ones myself, although I wouldn't buy one because apparently spares are rather hard to get. But I have no problem getting spares for GlenDronach single malt. Do you like the link? The lead-in? GlenDronach has been very much the talk of single malts 2012. And briefly, the history, the recent history of GlenDronach is that it's a Speyside distillery, an East Speyside area. Always has had plenty of character, but was owned until recently by Pernod Ricard, the second largest producers of Scotch whisky in the world, and the owners of Chivas Regal. Some of this kind of went into their blends, but generally it didn't really sparkle as a single malt. But in 2008, as the distillery was surplus to Pernod Ricard's requirements, as far as I'm aware, they sold it to the Benriach Whiskey Company, who have received a large loan from the bank and been investing heavily in putting out what is in the warehouses at GlenDronach. And it so happens there's a lot of good stuff, in particular sherried stuff. For those of you who like sherried whiskies, those dried fruit, raisin, big tannins, tea notes, the kind of slight menthol and bitterness that you get with heavy sherry notes, you're going to love this. It really is where sherried single malts are at, although you'll also find some good sherried whiskies at Macallan, Aberlour and Glengrant, to name just a few. Tasting notes in this one. Now, some of you who have been watching Ralphie.com will have noticed that it's the 15-year-old revival which has been my whisky of the year 2012. And the reason I'm reviewing this 19-year-old single cask is that GlenDronach have released on a fairly continuous basis a steady stream of single cask versions of their whisky, aged roughly from 14 to 40 years old. The majority are certainly well worth it. Some of the single casks sparkle, they're very good indeed. Some are kind of so-so. You've got to be careful what you're going for, but you will find there is plenty of resources online at Whisky Fun, at the Malt Maniacs, and at Whisky Base, to name but a few dependable and very reliable resources, where you will find information on what casks to go for. Another thing that you should note, my merry malt mates, is I'm going to have to break some bad news here. This particular 19-year-old 1993 Oloroso butt single cask bottling is only available in the UK. However, it is certainly the case that there are other single cask bottlings from a lot of distilleries which are not available in the UK, but you will find in other countries around the world. So if you don't see one, you'll soon find another. Nose. Rich, spicy, sweet sherried malt. Of course it's sherried, it says so in the label. But some sherries can be much more restrained than others. Some are obviously sherry, it really comes through, and others are much more chameleon in the way they interact with the single malt. However, this one is most certainly a medium to dry Oloroso. People tend to think Oloroso is sweet all the time. That's basically what the Spanish put in ice cream, a dessert sherry. But you do get dry Olorosos, and I'll be coming to that shortly in another vlog. Toffee, raisin, rum. Raisin and rum, dark chocolate. Cadbury's make it. You'll probably buy it on eBay if you're looking for it. Baked banana. Clove, licorice, vanilla, tropical honey. Oh, this is as rich and as old school sherry as you're going to find nowadays, actually. It's an excellent nose. It really is. I mean, just the sheer number of little tasting, of nosing smells that I can identify is testament to that. You know, the strong English breakfast tea, lemon oil, wood spice, and lots of nutty, spicy, something or otherness. Spiciness, that's what it is. When you add water to this, and it is bottled at 54.2%, so pretty strong, you will get much more interesting sherry wood, tannic sherry wood, and dry spice coming through, and laterally some perfume notes and naphthalene. Not napalm, naphthalene. For those of you who don't know what naphthalene is, basically mothballs put in wardrobes to preserve, particularly fur coats, from being attacked by fur coat eating moths. Fascinating. Taste wise, and I'm going to add a little bit of water to this, by all means start off tasting it neat just to get your bearings, but for a sherried whisky, this can take quite a lot of water. But I'll explain the reason for that shortly. Ooh, is it ready yet? Yep, that's perfect. Sweet and sour. Lovely balanced sweet and sour. Fresh, clean, rich sherry arrival. Very much emphasis on the dried fruits with figs and dates. And it's swiftly drying off with tannins coming in with camphor and barley sugar from the malt itself. Burnt sugar, not E150A, not added colourant, but actual almost burnt toffee notes. That little carbon taste in the development, along with clove, cumin, and allspice. Some black pepper in the background there, giving a little bit of nice oily heat. Some coal tar, sweet leathery smoke, and with water you'll find that you get an appearance of bitter salt citrus complexity, which remains from the right through from the soon after the arrival into the development through right through to the finish. The finish of which is pretty clean, vanilla, raisin, tannin, and some ginger root. My additional notes here are that water really redresses the balance between the cask influence and the single malt influence, as they kind of go head to head with each other to see who's going to dominate. It is a but, and that means bigger vessels mature more slowly, therefore at 19 years old. However, it tastes more like a 16-year-old whiskey. But there's a little more complex than that. It isn't tasting just younger than it should be. Basically, it's tasting fresher and more lively than you would get from a 19-year-old smaller cask, which would be more dominated by the wood and the previous content of the cask. But with big volume butts, they work a little more slowly. But one of the great things is between 18 and 21 years old in particular, butt-sized barrels and capacity 450 litres plus, what they can do is they're very good at giving that complex cask influence, but helping, but retaining the freshness of the spirit that's come out of the still, so that's not getting swamped. After water development, it really shows a wonderful complexity with these leathery tobacco, mason, mustardy notes that you can get with a clean, good quality sherry cask. And although I have mentioned, I'll emphasise again, it says in the label, there we label it aside, this has been bottled for the UK. It's only available in the UK. However, there are other casks out there available in other countries around the world. It really depends on how fortunate you are, wherever you are, with what you have available. And don't forget, by the way, it's not just Scotch whisky. You may find there's other spirits in your local retailers, which are actually well worth exploring, because they're off the radar, there's not a great deal of demand for them, and it can be that in order to sell them, they've got to keep the quality a bit higher. Right, there we go. And a mark, we've got to have a malt mark. We always do, you know. If it's a malt, it's a good one, it's a good one. 91, ooh, out of 100. That's a malt mark. So, a few more comments. I'll start with the current fashion for spotting sulphur in sherry casks. Do not look too hard for sulphur in sherry matured whiskies. If it's there, you'll notice it. If there's too much, it can flatten the finish of a, and spoil the finish of a single malt. The reason for sulphur in sherry casks is that it's burnt in the form of candles. Once the sherry's been emptied out these barrels and butts and hogsheads, they can be stored for several months before being sold and transported to another country for maturing whiskey, whether it be Scotland, Japan, Australia, wherever. And because the alcoholic strength of sherry is 20%, so it's not spirit strength, it's a lower strength, it means when these sherry casks are emptied, there's not such an intense alcohol content to help preserve the interior and stop bacterial growth, because bacteria feed off sugar, as does yeast, of course. And there will always be certain residues of sugar inside casks. So in order to sterilise these casks, the sherry producers burn sherry candles. They put them in and the smoke's generated inside the cask. And then they seal the cask up and it's basically sanitised. The problem is nowadays, and all distillers have to be so careful and check sherry casks once they've been bought and delivered to the warehouse, because too much sulphur can be used when whoever's sending the casks perhaps wants to mask the fact that the cask's already rancid, or the previous sherry content was of very poor quality, or perhaps it was just an inferior cask for whatever reason, and a way of disguising it is to burn extra sulphur candle inside so as to mask the inferiority. Always the best sign of a good quality cask is to simply remove the bung off it and smell. You're looking for a fresh sweetness and an energy, a certain ozone vitality inside a good decent cask. If the cask has become infected, you'll get a sour note, bitter, kind of heavily acidic, vinegary note. That's what you get. So there we are, a little bit of more information. I hope this all helps. Thank you for joining me for the first review in 2013. As you can see, we've had a little bit of a makeover here in the bothy. We've got some extra mould growing on the wall just to celebrate another year. And if you pop back again for Whiskey Review 331, which will be coming along soon, I will be discussing in a little bit more detail about sherry, and I will be setting you, yes, you merry maltsters, a sherry challenge. As if you're prepared to accept the challenge. You'll have to wait and see what it is. Join me again shortly when I shall be sharing another whisky moment. Yes, sharing the knowledge. That's what it's all about. Don't keep it all to yourself. Share it. Because everybody is a little bit more aware, and everybody is all the richer. Knowledge is a wonderful thing, and so much knowledge is in fact down to learning from experience and challenging established dogmas and all that stuff. Anyway. I'm going to have to go, guys. We seem to have a little emergency going on here. We'll see you soon.